I want to look at some things tonight about faith, positive faith. Faith is positive, and just give you some scriptures. Many which you already know, but stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance. Jesus said in Mark 11:24, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them. Now that's positive, isn't it? So where believing is mentioned, we have the word believing there. What things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them. That is when you pray, and ye shall have them. That's positive. That's a sure thing. So where believing is mentioned, it's a sure thing. It's positive. In Matthew 21 and verse 22, he said a similar thing. All things whatsoever ye shall ask in prayer, believing, ye shall receive. Well, that's positive then. So where believing is mentioned, it's positive. You will receive. Not hope so, think so, maybe so, but it's a know so. That is K-N-O-W. I know it's so. Believing, you shall receive. Well, in Matthew 17, Jesus said in verse 20, he answered their question about why they didn't get results in that situation. It was because of your unbelief. For verily I say unto you, if ye have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove. Nothing shall be impossible unto you. So here faith is mentioned, and it's a positive result. Not maybe so, not hope so, not I guess we think so, but it's an absolute positive result. It shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Where faith is mentioned, where believing is mentioned. Well, in Mark chapter 9 and verse 23, Jesus said, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. So again, where believing is mentioned, where faith is mentioned, it's a positive result. Not a hope so, not a maybe so. I wonder if we even think so. But it's an absolute positive result. Where faith is mentioned and where believing is mentioned, it's positive. Well, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 18 and verse 19, he said, if two on earth shall agree. Well, that's on earth. And that's where the authority to agree is. If two on earth, if two shall agree on earth. If two shall agree on earth, that's on earth. I put the earth in first because sometimes I emphasize that. I want to mention verse 18. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. In the Greek, it's past tense, something that's in the will of God. You already know it's the will of God in heaven. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You already know it's the will of God from the word of God. So heaven's already agreeing with it. See, in the Greek, it's past tense, is already bound in heaven. But see, heaven backs it. The authority to release the power of God is through the church on the earth in the name of Jesus. So if you bind anything on earth, well, then heaven will back it. If you lose something on earth, heaven will back it. See, earth is mentioned, heaven is mentioned. Heaven really does not have the authority to do things apart from covenant man or woman, mankind on earth in the name of Jesus, by the word of God, by the spirit of God in the name of Jesus. The will of God is being done through the church. In my name, go. And so verse 18 refers to the earth and to heaven. And so this two is on earth. Verse 19, it's the two on earth that are agreeing. If two shall agree on earth, is touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. So again, that's a positive thing. So where believing is mentioned, where faith is mentioned, and here where agreeing is mentioned, it's a positive thing. It's for sure. Agreement is operating under the same rules as faith. So agreeing is faith in tandem. See, this is not intercession. This is not supplication. In these areas, it's a positive thing. It says it will be done. Like in James chapter 5. And I'm going to flip through. We could quote these and refer to these. But in James chapter 5 and verse 14, it says, is there any sick among you? Call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save or heal. The Greek word there also means heal the sick. And the Lord shall raise him up. That's a positive thing. So again, where faith is mentioned, where believing is mentioned, where agreeing is mentioned, it's always with a positive outcome. It's an absolute sure thing. It's for sure it happens. In 1 John chapter 3, John wrote in verse 22, whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And this is his commandment, that we should twofold, that we should believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave his commandment. Twofold. This is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave his commandment. Well, this right here says, if we ask it, we receive, because we're walking in fellowship and obedience with him. We keep his commandments, do the things that are pleasing. In fact, verse 20 and 21 talks about if your heart condemns you or if it doesn't condemn you. If your heart condemns you, you won't have confidence. That's why you need to make things right. And John said in 1 John 1, to confess your sin, he's faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Our righteousness is by faith in the blood, Paul wrote to the Romans. And thank God for the precious blood. And when I appropriate the precious blood, confessing my sin, he's faithful and just to forgive and to cleanse. And in a moment, in an instant, the righteousness is restored. He cleanses me from all unrighteousness. I have faith in his blood. My heart doesn't condemn me. And my righteousness is of him. It's not by works of righteousness, which I've done, but according to his mercy, he saved me. By the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. That's Titus 3:5. And so I put my faith in the precious blood. I own up to it. And immediately in an instant, it doesn't matter what it did. It doesn't matter how long it did it. It doesn't matter. And it's just in an instant. God doesn't wait a while. He doesn't say, well, come next week and we'll start answering your prayers because we want to watch what you do for a week. As soon as you confess it, as soon as you acknowledge it, as soon as you appropriate the precious blood of Jesus Christ, you're cleansed, forgiven and cleansed, forgiven and cleansed, forgiven and cleansed. Well, if that's the case, then 1 John 3 qualifies. My heart doesn't condemn me. That's why James said, submit to God and resist the devil. Just resisting the devil with a command and you're not submitting to God, you're really not in the fellowship of faith. Faith is not a formula. It's not just a command. It's walking in the light and living by faith. And then the shield of faith, as Paul wrote to the Ephesians in chapter 6, quenches every fiery dart of the wicked, because it's the shield of faith, and faith is the fellowship and walking in the light. If I'm going to resist the devil, James said, submit to God, because if your heart condemns you, it won't work. But if your heart doesn't condemn you, then you have confidence. And whatever you ask, you receive. Well, that's a positive thing. Whatever I ask, I receive. That's a positive thing. And then John also said in 1 John chapter 5, verse 14, this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. Well, James said, you have not because you ask not, but he said, you ask and receive not because you ask amiss, to consume it upon your own lust. Well, if I'm asking with the wrong motive, I'm not going to get it. He also said, if I'm wavering, I'm not going to get it. But if it's in line with the word of God and I stand my ground, I hold fast to the profession of my faith. I don't cast away my confidence. It's in line with the will of God, the word of God, and it's not with an ulterior motive, or even if it's not ulterior, it's not with the wrong motive. I'm not asking amiss to consume it upon my own lust. Well, John said that if we ask anything according to the will of God, then we know he hears us. And if we know he hears us, then we know we have the petitions that we desired of him. So that's a positive thing. I have these verses marked in my Bible. If I ask something in line with the will of God, the word of God, my heart doesn't condemn me. I don't have a wrong motive. I see that it's in the word of God and I'm submitting to God. I'm in the fellowship of the Spirit of God. I'm asking according to his will. Well, I know he hears me. And if I know he hears me, see, John just makes it a positive thing. The outcome is for sure. We know. K-N-O-W. We know. Not a think so, maybe so, hope so, but it's a know-so reality. We have it. And he didn't here say it's future tense, though in a way it is, but we have it now. Certainly it's coming. You plant seed, you plant it now, and it's coming. But he said, we know we have the petitions that we desired of him. Faith is positive. Faith is positive. And if you'll maintain that positive outlook, you'll whip the devil when he comes to try to defeat you. When he tries to pull you away with your thought life, we ought to bring every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. We ought to cast down imaginations. We ought to take authority over our thought life and make sure we're doing what Philippians 4:8 says, and thinking on things that are honest and true and just and pure and lovely and of good report. When there's virtue, when there's praise, we think on these things and bring every other thought captive, casting down imaginations, as Paul said in 2 Corinthians 10. Take dominion over your thought life and if the devil comes, attacks you with thoughts in your mind or circumstances, you just keep him in the arena of faith. I believe what God's word has said, and I'm walking by that and not by sight, and you will whip him on every hand because it's a no-so. We have the petitions that we desired of him. Faith is positive. Now, this is when I'm praying for myself. Or sometimes you can make faith work for other people, but you can always make faith work for yourself. Sometimes your faith will work for other people, especially if you have their oversight, you have the spiritual care and responsibility of them. But sometimes you can help people if it's the first time they've heard it. Sometimes the second time they've heard it, because God will demonstrate some things through your faith, and you can carry some people and cover some people sometimes with your faith. But you can always make faith work for yourself. When you're praying for other people, though, often it's not the prayer of faith, it's supplication and or intercession. And there are places where this is also mentioned in Ephesians chapter 6. It says in verse 18, praying always with all prayer. Some translations say all kinds of prayer. Some translations say all manner of prayer. There are different kinds of prayer. And I think what the church at large, many, many Christians and ministers have done is they've confused prayer. They've made all prayer the same. Well, prayer is prayer. And they've just made it all the same. Like they dump it in a sack, put it in a sack, shake it up, and then dump it out. And it's just all prayer. But there's different kinds of prayer, and different kinds of prayer operate with different principles, or we could say rules. And one kind of prayer wouldn't operate the same way another kind of prayer would. The prayer of consecration, for example, can be prayed over and over again. Jesus said, the spirit's willing, but the flesh is weak. Not my will, but thy will be done. And so he's praying, Father, I want the will of God to be done. But when he raised Lazarus from the dead, he didn't pray that way. He didn't say, well, Lord, raise him from the dead if it be thy will, because there he knew the will of God. So he's praying a different kind of prayer that operates with a different principle. I mean, it's like sports. There's different kinds of sports. They have different rules. You don't play one sport using the other rules. You don't play basketball using baseball rules. I mean, if you did that, everybody would be confused. Sports are sports. Well, there are different kinds of sports, but they each operate with different kinds of rules, and you'd get confused if you didn't understand them. Well, the prayer of faith is going to be different from the prayer of consecration. The prayer of consecration is, Lord, I want to do your will. Whatever it is you want me to do, I'll do it. I just want to know your will and do your will. You could pray that every day. You could pray that every hour of every day. You could pray that over and over and again, Lord, your will in my life be done. I want to follow you and do your will. I desire to do the will of God. But when it comes to things that are by faith in the Word of God, you don't operate with those same principles. That's where you know the Word and you believe, you receive, and now count it done. You don't ask God again in the same way because you've already believed, you've received. If you've believed, you received, you now pray differently. In fact, if you try to get four and five people to agree with you when Jesus said two, it appears to me and demonstrates before the Lord that you don't even believe him and you're not taking him at his word. And certainly faith must take him at his word. And if he said two or three agree, then I'm going to stop right there and count it done. And I don't need to have more and more and more people agreeing. Now, if they agree, that's fine, but I'm not asking for it. If they tell me they are agreeing, that's fine, but I'm not asking them for prayer. If they tell me they're praying for me, that's fine, but I'm not asking for the prayer because in my own heart, I've settled it. The prayer of faith believes, it receives, and it's done. So the prayer of consecration and the prayer of faith are going to be different. And then intercession and supplication are different. When we're praying for other people, we can't always use our faith praying for other people because their lifestyle is involved. Their heart is involved. How they believe is involved. If we can carry them, and some people we can, like babies you can carry, people under your spiritual authority and oversight, that would be different. But if you're just praying for somebody you hear about, well, God knows everything. I don't know but a few things. Maybe I don't know anything. And so I can't pray a prayer of believing without the gift of faith. The gift of faith is God's faith mixing with my faith. That's different. But just my believing faith, I can't operate that for other people. That's why the Bible refers to intercession and supplication. Intercession and supplication are different. And so all prayer, Ephesians 6:18, all kinds of prayer, all manner of prayer, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. So you can pray prayers for other people, for all saints. And then verse 19, he said, pray for me. This is a good way to pray for preachers. Pray for me that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. Pray for me. So this is a good way to pray for ministers. You want to know how to pray for your pastor? This is a good prayer to pray. But praying always with all prayer, all kinds, all manner of prayer, supplication. Now, some translations use the word intercession for the next usage of supplication. If you notice in the King James, supplication is in there twice. But some translations have intercession in there the second time. And if you'll look it up, the one definition for supplication is interceding. And so they're very similar. The definition of supplication and the definition of intercession are very, very similar. Now, this says you're making these supplications and intercessions for all saints. I want you to notice, I just call to your attention, here, it's different. Here, it does not say it will be done. Now, other places where it used the words believing or agree or faith, it said it'll be done. You'll have it. We know we have it. We know it's done. I mean, maybe every previous verse we looked at, it was a positive thing. But here, it doesn't say it'll be done. So this is different. So intercession and supplication is different. And I think most people don't know this because I'll look at Facebook and somebody's asking for prayer for a loved one. And then 2 weeks later, they are announcing the home going. So the prayers didn't work. And yet, in the thread, you see believing, 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 agreeing, 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 commanding, speaking, and none of it worked. Because the church world at large, I mean, if it worked, they wouldn't have died, they would have lived. I was in a church one time. I didn't preach this particular Sunday. I did, but not this Sunday. I'm doing the music in this church. And after the music is over and I've sat down, the pastor has come up to the pulpit and he asked for a testimonies, or maybe somebody just raised their hand in the back. Pastor, I'd like you to pray for my uncle. He's in another state. We didn't know him. I don't know that anyone in that church knew this lady's uncle in another state. The doctors say he's dying with cancer. I'd like us to pray for him. Well, he prayed that God would heal that man. He commanded the cancer to go and God to heal that man. And then he asked, how many of you will believe? Let's all believe God. Let's all agree. And he asked the congregation, how many of you will agree with this that he's healed? Well, I'm right there on the front row. I've just done the music. I'm right on the front row. I feel rather conspicuous. Anybody in the church could look at me if they wanted to. I'm right on the front row. And he asked this question this way. How many of you will agree that he's healed? Raise your hand. Well, I couldn't raise my hand because see, agree, I already knew agree means it's positive. And for me, intercession and supplication is what we should have been doing because he's not in our church. It says in the old covenant in Ezekiel 22 and verse 30, I sought for a man among them to make up the hedge. See, he's not among us. So we can't really stand in the gap for him or make up the hedge for him. I sought for a man among them. Paul said in Romans chapter 8, verse 26, the Spirit helps us pray when we don't know how to pray or what to pray for as we ought. And the word helpeth there in the Greek, Romans 8, 26, the Spirit likewise helps us. That word help in the Greek, it's good to look some things up in the Greek. That word help in the Greek means takes hold together with us, against. So the Holy Spirit is taking hold with us against something. The Holy Spirit's taking hold with us against something. Well, he helps us because we don't know how to pray or what to pray for. Both are true. We don't know what to pray for and we don't know how to pray as we ought. So we're limited. That's one of our infirmities. So he helps our infirmities. That word infirmity in the Greek also means sickness. And when somebody's sick and we're interceding for that person, the Holy Spirit's helping our sickness. That the global, you know, the in our midst, not just you personally, but in your midst. So the Holy Spirit's helping our infirmity. But it's also true. Our infirmity is we don't know what to pray for as we ought. But he helps us and he's making intercession. Now, who's he making intercession for? Us, someone in the church. It might be another person, but in the church. Intercession and supplication can be made for anybody. Somebody said supplication is for the church and intercession is for the sinner. But here, intercession is for us. And as I've already pointed out, Ephesians 6, 18, the word supplication there in some translations is translated as intercession or interceding prayer. I think the Amplified Bible puts it that way, interceding prayer. And so intercession is done by the Spirit of God helping us. The Spirit makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Well, groanings, somebody said the Holy Spirit's praying for you. Well, this says he's taken hold with us against. Because the word helpeth in the Greek is takes hold with us. He's helping us. And these groanings escape my lips. This involves and includes speaking in tongues, but it also mentions groanings. That where you get beyond, you don't have any words, but you're groaning. Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. The Bible there says he groaned in the Spirit. Jesus didn't speak in tongues. That was for the church, the day of Pentecost. But he groaned. He groaned. He wept. And he groaned. Well, these groanings can still escape our lips. Where you're interceding for someone because the Spirit of God is coming upon you. And helping. Getting the job done, but using one of us. Well, he's searching. Verse 27 says he's searching. I think of Ezekiel 22, 30. I sought for a man. He's searching. Ezekiel 22, 30. I sought for a man among them to make up the hedge, stand in the gap. He didn't find anybody, but he was looking. and the things that he desired didn't happen. Recompense was put upon them, but he didn't want that recompense to be put upon them because he's looking for somebody to stand in the gap. I mean, they did not receive the blessing of God, but God wants them to. Why would God be looking for somebody to stand in the gap and make up the hedge unless he's wanting to bless them? Can somebody say amen? He's wanting to bless them. Instead, their own way, he recompensed to them because they had used robbery and vexed the stranger wrongfully. It says there in verse 29, I think it is. And so their own way, he recompensed to them, but he didn't want that to happen. He wanted the blessing to come. He wanted them to be protected. Even though they've done wrong, he wanted them protected. I mean, you look closely at Ezekiel 22, 29 and 30. Even though they've done wrong, he wanted to protect them. Or else why is he looking for somebody? I just believe God can just do what he wants to do. There he's looking for somebody. He's going to use somebody to stand in the gap, and he's looking for somebody among them, not across town, not in another village, not in another part of the world. Now, God can do that. God can use that. But the first place he looks is who you're among. I sought for a man among them to stand in the gap, make up the hedge. I didn't find anybody. And it just is one man, not 100, not all prayer warriors. We're going to bombard the gates of heaven. I tell you, when it's intercession by the Spirit of God, one person gets it done. One person gets it done. Old time Pentecostals used to call it a burden to pray. You've got a burden to pray. You might be in that place of prayer for hours. You've got a burden to pray, and you pray until you've got a note of victory. You might laugh or you might sing a song. You just have some lightness and victory in your heart. You know you've got the answer. And when you have the answer, you do. You've got the answer. And God is looking for someone. I sought for a man among them. In Romans 8, 26 and 27, it says he's searching the hearts. He knows what is the mind of the Spirit. He's making intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Now, James said it this way, referring to intercession. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. The Amplified Bible says it's the continued heartfelt prayer. Well, it doesn't say it's done. It says it makes it available. The earnest, the effectual, fervent, the earnest, heartfelt, continued prayer. She can put that up in the King James and the Amplified. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. But that's verse 16, James 5:16. But the Amplified Bible says it's the earnest prayer, and it's continued, and it's heartfelt. The earnest, heartfelt, continued prayer of a righteous man makes tremendous power available. It doesn't say it's done, but it makes it available. Now see, in the previous verses where we looked at faith and believing and agreeing, it said it's done. If it said believing, it said it's done. If it said believe you receive, it said you'd have it. It said if it's the prayer of faith, the Lord will raise him up. If you're agreeing, it is done for them of my Father which is in heaven. James said in chapter 1, ask in faith, nothing wavering. When you're asking in faith, he said, it'll be given. God gives to all men liberally and upbraideth not. It doesn't say hope so, think so, maybe so, says it will be given. So again, I want to remind you, call to your attention, where faith is mentioned, where believing is mentioned, where agreeing is mentioned, it says it's done. It's a positive thing. But where we see scriptures that mention intercession, we don't find that. When we see scriptures that mention supplication, we don't find that. It doesn't say it'll be done, but here in James 5, it says it'll make it available. Another place that we can look at is at Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6. Be careful for nothing. That means don't be anxious, don't fret, don't have any anxiety about anything. That means don't worry about anything. Don't worry about anything. It's like what Peter said, casting all your care upon the Lord because he cares for you. 1 Peter 5:7. Don't worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. I mean, if it's the right kind of prayer, you're mixing thanksgiving with it. But again, here it doesn't say it's done. You're letting your request be made known unto God, but you're praying for someone else. And it doesn't say it'll be done. It makes it available. Now, when the Spirit of God is taking hold with you, Romans 8, 26, 27, verse 28 says all things work together for good. There, what you've prayed about by the Spirit of God is going to work together for good. But that's when the Spirit of God's taking hold. When the Spirit of God is taking hold with you, He's searching the hearts. He knows the mind of the Spirit. He's looking for somebody to stand in the gap. But when that's not the case, sometimes we're just praying. We see someone, we see a need, we see a situation, and we enter into prayer. And we're praying, we're supplicating. The Spirit of God may not be taking hold with us. We may not have a burden to pray, as old time Pentecostals used to say, but we're praying just with our own understanding. Well, it doesn't say it'll be done. We may not know. The Spirit of God may or may not reveal it to you. You may or may not know, but we're encouraged to pray. But we don't use the word believing. That would be out of place. In that church where he said, raise your hand, how many of you will agree that that man is healed of cancer? I didn't raise my hand, but I looked around. You didn't forget about that, did you? We want to go back to that church then. We don't want to just leave those hands up in the air. I didn't raise my hand, but I looked around and everybody else had their hand up that I can see. I didn't turn all the way around. But every person I saw had a hand up in the air. And then he said, just raise your other hand. Let's just praise God. I believe that's what he said next. But he's asking, how many of you will agree? Let's all believe God. Raise your hand. I didn't raise my hand. I felt rather conspicuous right there on the front row. And I'm the only one without the hand up. What's wrong with Brother Tony? I don't think it's right that he doesn't pray for other people. The prayer of faith's not going to work here. Believing's not going to work here. The next Sunday, I was also in that church, and they announced that man's homegoing. They announced, you know, they're asking for prayer for the family, the comfort of the family. And they announced the funeral that she couldn't be here, and she's got something. You know, she's asking for prayer for the family. Well, that would have been a wonderful opportunity, maybe not that day. But Jesus said in Matthew 21, 22, all things whatsoever you shall ask for in prayer, believing you shall receive. We all said we were believing and we didn't receive. So something's amiss here. I don't believe Jesus lied about it. Jesus said, believing you will receive, and we didn't receive. And yet we, not me, but the rest of the church, said we were believing. As a church whole, we said we were believing. And yet we didn't receive. And Jesus said, all things whatsoever you shall ask for in prayer, believing, you shall receive. So the fallacy of composition here is we're praying one kind of prayer, but trying to use another kind of prayer's rules. And you can't do that. It won't work. It won't apply. They're trying to intercede with faith rules. The prayer of faith and the principles that govern the prayer of faith. Believing is a principle of the prayer of faith. Interceding doesn't use the word believe. If we look at the verses in the New Testament that mention interceding and supplication, believe and faith are not there. You don't find the word believe in the same verse with intercede and supplicate. You don't find the word. Now, of course, you're believing that you're having an effect. You're believing you're making it. It's available. You're believing God hears you. There is an aspect of believing, but you're not believing the prayer is answered and it's done. That would be the prayer of faith. Believe that you receive and you'll have it. Interceding doesn't operate with that. And sometimes these things are confusing even when people hear them the first time. That's why I keep teaching on it, keep teaching on it, keep teaching on it. Because when I look at Facebook and somebody is asking for prayer for a relative or a friend, and the thread is believing, 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 believing. And then 2 weeks later, they announce the person's funeral. I think these people ought to learn some teaching about believing and the prayer of believing. You weren't believing, or else Jesus is wrong. Because Jesus said, all things whatsoever you shall ask for in prayer, believing, you'll receive. And you said you were believing, you were asked for it in prayer, believing, and you didn't receive it. So Jesus must be wrong here. We need to just tell Jesus, explain it to him, teach him. No, it's not Jesus who's wrong. It's the church in many areas are wrong. The church is, for the most part, on the subject of prayer, the church has gotten things confused and put all prayer in one sack and just shook it up and then dumped it out, and trying to make all prayer operate with the same principles, and it won't work. Intercession, I've looked at the verses here in Philippians 4:6. It doesn't say it'll be done. It doesn't use the word faith. It doesn't say believing. It doesn't say agreeing. It just says supplication, prayer and supplication. In Ephesians 6, what we just looked at, it mentioned a supplication. In other translations, intercession, but it doesn't say it'll be done. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, here's another place we can look at. 1 Timothy chapter 2, Paul there is talking about prayer, and he said prayer is made for all men. So you can pray for anybody, not just people that are in the church, not just people that are saved, but anybody. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1, I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. One translation of the Bible says pray everywhere, every way you know, for everybody you know. Just all kinds of prayer for everybody. But I want to call to your attention, it doesn't say it'll be done. It doesn't say you'll receive. It doesn't say you'll have it, because, and believing is not mentioned, and faith is not mentioned, and agreeing is not mentioned. So where intercession is mentioned and where supplication is mentioned, faith is not. And where intercession is mentioned and supplication is mentioned, it doesn't say it'll be done. But where faith is mentioned, it does say it'll be done. Where believing is mentioned, it does say it'll be done. Where agreeing is mentioned, it does say it'll be done. So we have different kinds of prayers that operate with different principles, and we should not confuse them. We'll get better results if we understand how prayer works. When I understand how to pray for myself, I'll get better results when I understand how to pray. But when I'm praying for other people, I understand I'm not applying my faith, believing it's done. I'm interceding and supplicating, and sometimes all I'm doing is making it available to them. And I'll get more results praying for other people if I understand how prayer works. If I understand to stay there and get into the Spirit until the Spirit takes hold with me. And sometimes that's ours. If I really care about that person, I'm going to stand there in the spirit of intercession. I want the Spirit of God to take hold with me. I'll get more done if I get into the realm of the Spirit and He takes hold with me. Because if He doesn't take hold with me, then I'm not getting the results maybe that I could get. Sometimes He won't. I've had Him speak to me and said, don't pray, because there's things that you don't know. They're not in the place they can receive. And there's more to the story. Sometimes He tells you, sometimes He doesn't. There's more to the story. Can somebody say amen? A lady came to me one time and wanted me to pray that she'd get a good grade on the test that she's supposed to take in the morning. I told her I couldn't pray that prayer. Pray for me that I'll get a good grade. I'm taking an exam or a test tomorrow. Pray that I'll get a good grade. I said, I can't pray that. I have no idea if you've even studied. I don't know if you even know the material. I don't know if you've wasted the last 2 weeks of your time. You've had 2 weeks to prepare and you've wasted. I can't pray that prayer. She's wanting me to pray a prayer of faith, believing when it involves her. I can't do that. I think it kind of shook her when I told her, no, I can't pray that. You can't. No, I don't know if you'll get a good grade or not. I can pray and agree with you that you'll have a clear mind, and that God will give you the ability to understand. But you have to study. You have to do some things. There's some things that are required of you, and I can't do those things for you, and God won't do those things for you. So I can't pray that you'll get a good grade. I don't know what you've done to prepare, but I can pray that you'll have a clear mind, and God will give you understanding. I mean, you get busy. Like Daniel, he understood things that the king's best didn't understand, because of the Spirit of God, because of the presence of God. I mean, we have an advantage. Amen. We can apply ourselves and come away with the understanding of things that others do not understand, and we get a hold of it quicker than they do, because He affects the understanding that He gives us. It's spiritual, and it's also, He affects our brain, our mind, and we have the ability to comprehend quicker if we'll apply our faith in those areas. But I didn't pray that she'd get a good grade. No, I can't do that. Amen. But when we understand these things, you can pray. you can believe when you know that it's in God's word. When you go to his word and you see that it's his will. Whatever we ask, if it's according to his will, 1 John chapter 5. Whatever we ask, if it's according to his will, we know he hears us. And if we know he hears us, then we know we have the petitions that we desired of him. Can you say amen, somebody? Faith is positive. The outcome is sure.